We begin today with breaking news in our politics lead. Under assault from all sides over a policy that separated children from their parents at the border, President Trump did something today that we have never before seen him do as president. He surrendered, taking a step that for weeks he has falsely insisted was not possible. He stopped the practice of child separation himself, he says. The president claimed he was not backing down, but he did just sign an executive order that he said would, quote, keep families together while ensuring we have a powerful border. The president acknowledging there was pressure from both his wife and his daughter Ivanka to end the separation policy that his own administration instituted.
No, Ivanka feels very strongly. My wife feels very strongly about it. I feel very strongly about it. I think anybody with a heart would feel very strongly about it. We don't like to see families separated. At the same time, we don't want people coming into our country illegally.
President Trump also faced pleas from Republicans on Capitol Hill to stop the new practice at the border, which could prove calamitous, they fear, to them at the polls in November. We're getting a new look, meanwhile, at the headwinds that congressional Republicans already are facing. On the generic ballot in our brand new CNN poll, Democrats are gaining even more of an advantage. Our polling shows a Democrat beating a Republican by 8 points on the generic ballot. That's a 5-point boost for Democrats since last month. That 8-point advantage, experts say, could be enough to flip the House to Democratic control in November, especially when combined with a significant enthusiasm gap. Our new poll showing that 55% of Democrats say they're enthusiastic about voting in November. That compares with 40% of Republicans, a 15-point gap. Bad news for Republicans, who obviously need to do a better job of getting their voters excited and heading to the polls. This hour, President Trump is trying to do just that. He's aboard Air Force One, hitting the campaign trail, ramping up his political schedule at the exact same time that Republicans are on the defensive over the child separation practice, which the president says he just ended, a rare retreat by a president who prides himself on never apologizing. The pressure on the administration against the policy hit something of a fever pitch yesterday, with Senate Republicans announcing that they unanimously opposed it. In addition, the president's Homeland Security Secretary was accosted and shouted down by Democratic socialists as she tried to eat at a Mexican restaurant last night. The sounds of crying children were blared on speakers played by a Democratic super PAC as big donors hit a Trump Hotel fundraiser. And then, of course, his former campaign manager, Corey Lewandowski, was lambasted for responding rather callously to news of a little girl with Down syndrome who'd been separated from her mother at the border. CNN's Caitlin Collins joins me now live at the White House. Caitlin, do we know exactly what got President Trump to completely flip and decide he wants to sign this order?
Well, Jake, that's the question I asked President Trump in the Oval Office that he chose not to answer. What we are witnessing is something we rarely, if ever, have seen from President Trump, and that is Trump backing down. Now, as he sat there at the Resolute desk signing this executive order on ending the separation of families at the border, he was stood next to the Department of Homeland Security Secretary Kirstjen Nielsen, who said just 3 days ago that this was a policy that didn't exist. President Trump abruptly reversing course today, signing an executive order to end the separation of families on the border.
So we're going to have strong, very strong borders, but we're going to keep the families together. I didn't like the sight or the feeling of families being separated.
A striking about-face from a president who has refused to back down, insisting only yesterday that he had just two choices.
Those are the only two options. Totally open borders or criminal prosecution for lawbreaking.
Contradicting himself.
Now, wait, you can't do it through an executive order.
And aides who have maintained their hands were tied.
Well, I think at the end, Congress has the power to fix this.
Congress and the courts created this problem, and Congress alone can fix it.
Trump now hoping to defuse a crisis of his own making on the southern border with the stroke of his pen. But an executive order isn't required to end the separations. Sources telling CNN the president wanted to look decisive, telling aides it would look badly if he reversed the policy quietly.
The dilemma is that if you're weak, which some people would like you to be, if you're really, really pathetically weak, the country is going to be overrun with millions of people. And if you're strong, then you don't have any heart.
Tensions reached a boiling point in recent days as images of children separated from their parents and kept in cages continued to surface. The Secretary of Homeland Security, Kirstjen Nielsen, confronted by protesters while dining at a Mexican restaurant in Washington.
If kids don't eat in peace, you don't eat in peace!
Trump telling aides he knew the images looked bad politically, but insisting the media was only showing the worst ones.
Those images affect everybody, but I have to say that you have double standards.
But the administration could be back to square one in a matter of days. Sources say the executive order won't end the zero-tolerance policy that led to the separations in the first place, and an order could create an entire slew of legal problems.
We're going to keep families together, but we still have to maintain toughness, or our country will be overrun by people, by crime, by all of the things that we don't stand for, that we don't want.
Now, the text of this executive order that the president signed does instruct families to be kept together when possible. But during that signing in the Oval Office, shortly before the president left the White House, he did say that this could be open to legal issues with this executive order and still referenced legislation, which shows, Jake, that though the president is reversing course here, we still could be a ways away from the end of all of this.
All right, Caitlin Collins at the White House for us. Thank you so much. My political panel joins me now. We're going to dive into immigration throughout the whole show. I do want to start with this new CNN polling. Let's put the numbers back up, showing that Democrats win in a generic ballot 50% to 42%. That's an 8% gap. That is a 5-point bounce from last month. Josh Holmes, you're a professional Republican. You want Republicans to win the House and Senate and keep them. How worried do these numbers make you?
Well, it's bounced around a little bit, but I think this is pretty consistent with what we've seen. I think the average at this point is about 6.77% in a midterm where one party controls every lever of Congress. It's not abnormal to have this. The intensity is another piece of this that is pretty consistent. I think that where Republicans can take heart, at least on the Senate side, is the makeup of the electorate in some of these states that they're targeting. A general, what we're looking at here, national numbers, reflects an awful lot of people who are in states that frankly don't vote in Senate elections in 2018. So, you know, North Dakota, Missouri, Indiana, West Virginia, places like that, there are going to be an awful lot more Republicans that may have very different motivations than the general electorate as a whole.
Fair enough. Let's talk about the enthusiasm gap. A 15-point enthusiasm gap. Democrats, 55% enthusiastic vote. Republicans, 40%. What's driving that lack of enthusiasm? Is it President Trump? Is it congressional Republicans? What do you think?
Well, here's what really worries me. The policies that the administration is pushing are controversial. And be one thing if you are making progress on the immigration agenda because of what you're doing. But what they're doing right now is actively encouraging the Democratic base to get out the vote while depressing the Republican base because you aren't actually getting anything done. Look at what happened this week. Today, President Trump is writing an executive order to overturn his administration's own deterrence policy.
Right.
They have bungled this so badly, all it does is energize Democrats and depress Republicans.
Simone, let me ask you, I have to be honest, I'm a little surprised, given all the controversies of this president, that the gap isn't bigger for Democrats. In 2006, it was something like a 15-point gap. And that ended up being a wave that brought the Democrats to the House, and there was all of a sudden Speaker Nancy Pelosi. This is 8 points. We're still a few months out. I'm not saying it's over, but are you surprised that it's not bigger, that gap?
I'm not surprised it's not bigger. Look, when Donald Trump got elected, there were lots of nefarious things going on, things that he had said, troubling, problematic things from folks in his camp, which is now his administration. So I'm not surprised that the gap is so small. I will say, and I told it to the Washington Post a couple weeks ago, that I do not think the bulk of this enthusiasm is merely an anti-Trump enthusiasm. Because again, Democrats already didn't like Trump. If you don't like Trump, what he's done hasn't made you like him anymore. I think what a lot of this is folks seeing what is possible. If Donald Trump can be elected, damn it, so can I. And so that's why I think we've seen a record number of women put their name on the ballot to run for office as Democrats. There are every single seat in all the competitive states have a Democrat on the ballot challenging a Republican. That is unprecedented, Jay.
So let's talk about one of the headwinds that Republicans are facing, which is this child separation issue, even though President Trump obviously trying to quell it today with this new executive order. Ivanka Trump today tweeted, thank you, POTUS, President of the United States, for taking critical action, ending family separation at our border. Congress must now act, find a lasting solution. It's consistent with our shared values, the same values so many come here seeking as they endeavor to create a better life for their families. Thank you, POTUS?
I I don't care one bit about what she has to say on this issue. You know why? Because instead of actually doing some work, she went and asked Daddy about the pictures. If she were a real White House policy advisor, she wouldn't ask Daddy. She would go down to the border and look for herself, as would the Secretary of Homeland Security, as would Stephen Miller. Because you can tell when these people talk, they have not seen this with their own eyes. They have no idea what's happening down there. And so I don't want to hear about pictures. Get back to me once you go down and see it.
And yet, Ivanka Trump does wield power, and the president said that she and Melania Trump are some of the two of the main reasons, it sounds like, he wasn't quoting congressional right. Republicans, that he decided to sign this executive order.
Yeah, I mean, he clearly listens to what she has to say, and in this regard, I think it's a positive thing for the Republican Party and a positive thing for the country. I share your concern. I think any parent that looks at the situation like we saw on the border would be deeply concerned. And I think Ivanka has expressed the concern that most people do feel. Now, whether or not that she was the only person expressing that or not, I'm sure, certainly glad she did, because we're now in a place where we can put this terrible episode behind us.
And yet it seems like she's trying to cast her dad as the hero of the situation. Thank you, POTUS, for taking this critical action, ending family separation at our border. This was a practice that was in full thrust because of President
Trump administration.
Yeah.
I think they think we're stupid. I have said this more times than I would like, but they continuously think that we're stupid. I don't know what Ivanka Trump thinks she's doing wading in with a tweet. Look, she is a White House policy advisor. So the fact that she had to wait till she saw the photos run in and say, well, Dad, we don't know what she said, but I envision Ivanka talking about, well, Daddy, can you just do something about the policy? You are a White House advisor. Ivanka Trump in that position wields a lot of power. But what happens when your power comes merely from proximity and not because you're qualified has you going and doing things like that, like Ivanka Trump has done today. So, you know, the Trump administration did create this policy. The executive order is not going to do anything to get to the root of the issue. There's still a zero tolerance policy, and that's what we need to have.
There's one point in this, and maybe it's a silver lining. It wasn't until the pictures and the videos came out that anybody cared. Right. That these people were supposedly moved. I actually don't buy the idea that Melania and Ivanka convinced Trump to move. I think he read the media coverage.
Yeah.
And maybe the bright side is that Republicans, when they stand up, as they have, and said, we're not doing this, the governor's saying, we're not sending troops to the National Guard to help you do this, and we all look at the pictures, we're all horrified, that can move the president to do the right thing eventually. Maybe that's what we can take away from this.